Thank you, Eric, again for your introduction. And I'm going to try to give you up speed, a little update where we are with the percutaneous treatment for mitral regurgitation. You was wondering why mitral regurgitation right now, and you have all this beautiful development now with the aortic valve, but the problem is the mitral valve is a more complex valve than the aortic or the pulmonary valve that are quite advanced now percutaneously. And the reason is that it's not only the leaflets that are the part of the mitral valve, but the mitral valve is an apparatus that includes the anterior and the posterior leaflet, the papillary muscles, the cordis tendine, the geometry of the left ventricle, particularly the walls of the LV. And of course, any one of those could be a source of mitral regurgitation. So from the outset, it appears that you will not have a single device that will be able to fix mitral regurgitation percutaneously. And more likely, you probably will end up needing a combination of devices, essentially based on what the surgical data has shown us, that regardless of the type of mitral regurgitation, many of these patients will end up, for example, with a mitral annuloplasty after the repair has been performed. In terms of the percutaneous treatment, I think that we have clearly established the role of balloon valvuloplasty in mitral stenosis. I don't think that I'm going to talk at all about that. But in mitral regurgitation, again, it's the combination of all these components of the mitral valve that we need to work on it to try to decrease mitral regurgitation. And essentially, it's going to, what happened? There you go, Bill. So you could have simple way like trying to work on the leaflets, on the coronary sinus, but the majority of functional SMR is a huge field that hasn't even touched right now because it's not being treated by the surgeons because the high chance for morbid mortality on this very ill patient with very low ejection fraction. This kind of gives you a summary of the techniques that are available right now. Many of them are still on animal work, animal models. Some of them have initial clinical data. We had the bow tie technique. We will talk about that in a minute. The coronary sinus anatomically is close to the mitral annulus, and they have been trying to be used as a way to produce an external annuloplasty of the mitral valve. Then we have techniques that will produce plication of the annulus, particularly the mitraline and the guide delivery systems. And then there is a lot of effort on techniques that will change the geometry of the left ventricle, particularly for these functional and ischemic MRs. One of them is the use of the MyoCore, the coapsis system, and the PS3 device, that is the one that I have been working the most over the last 5 years. Where the H2S technique essentially is an extrapolation of an old technique created by Dr. Octavio Alfieri. This is the original paper he published. And essentially, Octavio was dealing with a very difficult mitral valve prolapse patient that he couldn't really repair surgically. And he came up with the idea that maybe he will just suture together the anterior and the posterior leaflet and create a double orifice valve that may decrease mitral regurgitation. That was the case on that particular case. And in addition to that, he didn't produce any significant mitral stenosis. So I remember very clear when we started mitral balloon valvuloplasty and my former boss, Peter Block, was thinking about, you know, we can do this bow tie technique. And Peter was thinking at that time how this could be done. It took a few years after that for me to came to learn about the engineer that have been working on this project to make it a reality. But this is an example of this Alfieri operation. You could see there the pathology specimen on this patient that ended up going to cardiac transplantation eventually. And you could see the joint of the anterior and the posterior leaflet right in the middle and the double orifice, and also as is being assessed by echocardiography in the other panel of the figure. Now, this is the long-term survival of the Alfieri operation as well done by Dr. Alfieri. But it's importantly that you could see here that 6-7 years of follow-up, 90% of the patients were free of reoperation. So these include all the arteries, of course, patients with or without annuloplasty. Definitely patients with annuloplasty did better than those patients without. The patient with non-calcifying annulus also did better. But the important issue is that 90% of these patients have a 7-year follow-up free of reoperation and with improved functional class heart failure. So this is kind of a beautiful system that was very carefully engineered, developed. And essentially, you have to put a very large cannula into the left atrium as a 24 French. And then through that, you're going to use a delivery system. And all what you need, all that equipment is to deliver this small clip here. This is the one that is going to do the work. But all these knobs that you see here, these three knobs, allow a very precise movement of that delivery system, anterior, posterior, north and south, and you are able to cross the mitral valve and put it in the middle of the mitral leaflet, and then essentially the rest is kind of boring. You have the echo to tell you when the leaflet has been grasped by the hooks that you could see here on the clip. When you are sure that you have grabbed the two leaflets, then essentially you deliver the system after reducing mitral regurgitation. Here is the first case that was done. This was actually was done in Caracas by Dr. Jose Condado and Dr. Patrick Willard. And you could see there the catheter going into the left ventricle with the open clip. You could see the mitral regurgitation before and after the grasping of the leaflets. This patient now is more than 3 years follow-up and remains asymptomatic with only 1+ of MR. And you could see there at the end the release of the clip. Following that, the technique came to the United States and essentially was part of a pivotal trial. It was the Everest One trial that included 27 patients with severe MR. These patients were limited either by congestive heart failure, chronic atrial fibrillation, and most of these patients were prolapsing valves. There was a small number of patients with functional MR, but essentially that was not the major market that was looking for this kind of system. The clip was implanted in 24 of the 27 patients. There is a very strong learning curve for this technique. The co-optation of both leaflets was achieved on all the patients, but the clip was only deployed on 24 patients. 60% of the patients that got the clip have a decrease of more than 2+ of mitral regurgitation at discharge, making them successful procedures. The primary endpoint was the presence of any major complications after the clip placement. That happened in 4 patients. 1 patient had a stroke. There were 2 patients that had detachment of the leaflet without embolization. It kept hold by one of the leaflets. And none of these patients have embolization, and they essentially had surgery if it was necessary. And it's important that from those patients that end up going to surgery, the clip could be removed, the valve could be repaired, if that was the need to do in those patients. The core echo lab examined all these patients before and at 30 days, that was the endpoint of the study, and they have a significant decrease on the amount of MR from almost plus to 4+ to a little bit over 1+. The surgical repair, again, was possible to be performed on all the patients that required surgery because either a successful procedure or because complications. This actually led to the Everest II trial. The Everest II trial actually completed enrollment in the fall of last year. We went for the results of this trial probably for the fall of this